MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about inhalers. So what's the quick and dirty on inhalers? Well, here we've got a bronchus, which is the airway that you breathe through. And in the middle of that is smooth muscle, which limits the aperture or the lumen of that bronchus. If the smooth muscle contracts, the lumen gets smaller. And so there's two major receptors that we see on this smooth muscle. We have an orange receptor here, which we're going to call the muscarinic receptor. So that's going to be an M. And there's another receptor. In this case, we'll call it the blue receptor, which is the beta receptor. So those are the two major receptors. Now, the thing that you should know is that muscarinic receptors are actually going to cause smooth muscle contraction. And so what we want to do in this situation is we want to make sure that we are inhibiting that. So we want to make sure that there's a big X, that we have inhibitors of that muscarinic receptor. On the beta side, however, we want to make sure that that gets excited or activated, because the beta receptor actually relaxes that smooth muscle. And so that's going to cause relaxation. So once you know about these two receptors and you know that you want to block the muscarinic and excite the beta to cause bronchodilation, then you're there. Now, the only other one that you should know is the inhaled corticosteroid, which we'll say here is a ICS. And that basically goes everywhere. There is no real receptor, but what it does is it reduces inflammation. Okay, so the three types of drugs that you can use for bronchi are muscarinic antagonists, beta agonists, and inhaled corticosteroids. So why is that important? Well, you'll be able to identify these different types of drugs based on what they end with. So muscarinic always end in I-U-M. So what are examples? Tiotropium, ipratropium, umeclidinium. These are all muscarinic antagonists. They all end in IUM. Now, there is another one that you should know that has been added to that category called glycopyrrolate. So you can also put L-A-T-E, glycopyrrolate. Okay? So if you see an IUM or a late, it's a muscarinic antagonist. Now, on the beta agonist side, all of these end in O-L. So you'll know famotidine, salmeterol, albuterol, all those things end in O-L. Now, how do you know whether it's an inhaled corticosteroid? You'll know that because it ends in O-N-E, or O-N-E, like fluticasone, mometasone, etc. So once you know those three, then you'll be able to put those together. So we have the muscarinic antagonists, we have the beta agonists, and we have the inhaled corticosteroids. So how are we going to use these in terms of the actual clinical outcomes? Let's take a look at that. Okay, so let's go ahead and put those medications into the right place. In terms of this, there are two types of beta agonists. There's something called a short-acting beta agonist, which I will call a SABA. Okay, so what does this represent? This represents like ProAir. This looks like Ventolin, albuterol, basically. Okay, now the other one that we're going to do are the long acting beta agonists. So that's LABA, L-A-B-A. Then we're going to go ahead and look at the long acting muscarinic antagonists. Okay, and then finally we're going to go ahead and look at the inhaled corticosteroids. So for those who don't remember, remember this, that these are the ones that end in O-N-E, these are the ones that end in O-L, and these are the ones that end in I-U-M. Remember, glycopyrrolate is also in that category. So it's I-U-M, O-L, and own. So why do I put this into this three-chambered box here with the SABA? This is how we're going to look at the treatment of COPD and asthma. Okay, so as you can see, if we take a look at asthma first, asthma is going to go in this direction, whereas COPD is going to go in this direction. So the first thing that we would do in asthma is we would add an inhaled corticosteroid. And then we would ask the question, is the patient using a short-acting beta agonist? If the answer is somewhere between 1 and 2 times per week, then we're fine with where we are at one medication. However, if the patient is using the short-acting beta agonist as a rescue inhaler 3 or more times per week in asthma, then the inhaled corticosteroid is not enough. Then what we need to do is add a long-acting beta agonist. At that point, we ask the question again, is the patient using a short-acting beta agonist or albuterol 3 or more times per week? If the answer is yes, that means the patient is not well controlled, and we will add not just an inhaled corticosteroid and a long-acting beta agonist, but we'll at that point add a long-acting muscarinic antagonist. At any point, if we ask this question, is the patient using a short-acting beta agonist, and the answer is no, 0 times per week, that means the patient is so well controlled they don't have to use the rescue inhaler. That means we can drop the long-acting muscarinic antagonist, if we're on that, or if we're just on the inhaled corticosteroid and the long-acting beta agonist, then we can drop the long-acting beta agonist and just keep on the inhaled corticosteroid. So what we're seeing here is a ramping up or a ramping down, depending on the answer to the question, how often is the short-acting beta agonist being used? Notice that for asthma, you will never use a long-acting beta agonist without using an inhaled corticosteroid first. Okay, now let's go to the other side, COPD. If you have COPD, the first medication that I would add is a long-acting muscarinic antagonist. So tiotropium, or umeclidinium, or glycopyrrolate. And then I would ask the question, is the patient using the short-acting beta agonist? If the answer is yes, 3 times or more per week, then I would add the long-acting beta agonist. Notice that the last thing I'm going to use in a patient with COPD is an inhaled corticosteroid. So this is very important. You'll see that a long-acting muscarinic antagonist is one of the first things that we'll use in a patient with COPD. But we're always asking the question, and you should see here very clearly that everybody who has a lung disease, either asthma or COPD here, is going to get a short-acting beta agonist as a rescue inhaler, that they carry it with them wherever they go. Okay, now, as you can see, at some point you're going to be having combination of medications. The drug companies are not stupid. They'll know that usually one medication's not enough. And so what you'll see for COPD is you'll see these LAMA-LABA combinations. And you see that all the time. So if you pick up an inhaler and it's a combination of a medication, you can simply look on there and see if they have a combination of an IUM medication and an OL medication. For instance, one medication has valanterol and umeclidinium. That would be a LAMA-LABA combination. Because you know this chart, you'll know that that medication is a medication that's going to be used for COPD. Let me give you another one. Let's go from the asthma side. You know that on the asthma side, people will be combining inhaled corticosteroids and long-acting beta agonists. So if you see something like fluticasone and salmeterol, that combination goes together and that forms Advair, for instance, and that would be a inhaled corticosteroid and a LABA combination. Now, you can get LABA by itself. You can buy salmeterol or formoterol by itself, but that is becoming more and more rare because, as you can see based on how I have things set up, that if you're on a LABA, you're either going to be coupling it with an inhaled corticosteroid when you're treating asthma, or you're going to be coupling it with a long-acting muscarinic antagonist if you're treating COPD. Now, as you can probably imagine, it's not going to be long before, and they have already started working on this, all three of these medications in one. So you can now look up basically any inhaler, look at the contents of the inhaler in terms of the medications, and you should be able to very quickly tell, first of all, what type of a medication it is and what it should be used for. And now with your patients, you'll be able to see whether or not you need to escalate therapy or de-escalate therapy. The one thing that I will say is, in the case of asthma, If I am going down, I go to an inhaled corticosteroid and that doesn't work, I will add a long-acting beta agonist. But there are exceptions to this. For instance, if I have a patient who has atrial fibrillation and I'm worried that I'm going to speed up their heart rate very quickly, instead of adding a long-acting beta agonist, which could speed up their heart, I may decide to increase the dose of the inhaled corticosteroid from a low potency to a medium or even to a high potency medication. Alternatively, I could also add a leukotriene receptor antagonist. And I didn't put that in here, but I'll just put it up here in the corner. Leukotriene receptor antagonist, and that is a type 4. Okay, so these are other things that you can think about, but this is the general modality that you'll see in the treatment between asthma and COPD. Thanks for joining us.